there.
No.
You have to eat one last one.
All right, good morning. We're going to jump right into the lecture. This is where I left off. We're still talking about innate immunity. All right, so complement is a cascade, and it's kind of like blood coagulation. You might have to memorize all those clotting factors. This one you don't have to memorize, but conceptually I want you to know what it is. Now if you look at the top of this slide, there's three ways to kick it off. There's classical pathway, lectin pathway, alternative pathway. The one I want you to know is the classical pathway to activate complement. Okay? So that classical pathway is activated when antibodies coat the pathogen, the target cell, the thing you're trying to obliterate, the foreign invader. So that term is called opsonization. And before I get into it, the reason why this term is used, complement, is because complement complements both the specific and non-specific defenses. That's what I want you to know. Complements both specific and non-specific defenses. Specific, non-specific defenses. So, how it complements the specific defenses is that classical pathway where antibodies coat the pathogen. There's pathogen, orange target cell, and we coat it with antibodies. There's my little Y-shaped antibodies, right? When you coat the antibodies around the pathogen for this thing you're trying to get rid of, that's called opsonization. Antibodies are a part of your specific defenses. So opsonization is how complement complements specific defenses. Okay. So what happens with opsonization, you're coating antibodies. You can fix complement to the pathogen. So antibody structure, I'll talk about it very simply. The forked end is the specific end of the antibody. And that's the end that is specific to this pathogen, this orange pathogen. Now the tail is a non-specific end. But that end will kind of bump into complement. In this case, this C3B. Kind of bumps into that. I'll just say bumps into complement. So in that way, it kind of like gets a ride, and it's gonna. This one is gonna. It's gonna fix complement to the pathogen. It's called complement fixation. So when you do that, when you coat the pathogen, number one, and also fix complement to it, what you're doing is you're increasing the chance that this pathogen will be phagocytized by a macrophage. You're increasing chance, this will be phagocytized, opsonization. Because the antibodies themselves don't obliterate the pathogen. They just kind of like arrest them, just kind of bind them up and hold them until the killers get there, the phagocytes. Antibodies aren't, we say, they're not the murderers. They're like accessories to murder. They just kind of help until the phagocytes get there. All right, so that's how you complement the specific defenses, opsonization. Now, complement can also enhance non-specific defenses by enhancing inflammation. So you can see this C3A will kind of enhance inflammation by stimulating histamine release, and that's kind of like the basophils. I'll just draw the C3A. Increases inflammation by increasing histamine release by basophils. So that's two things. You complement specific, non-specific defenses. The third thing is, for example, when you fix complement to a pathogen, my first example, the third thing that can happen is this, what's called this MAC attack. You punch holes, literally, in the cell membrane at the pathogen you're trying to destroy. So third thing, all right, MAC attack. That's all I'll say. You don't have to memorize that string of pearls. Basically, it's a complex that punches holes in cell membrane, causing lysis, cell bursting. Done. Now MAC stands for membrane attack complex, right? Punching a hole in the cell. All right, so that's complement, part of your non-specific defenses. And it's the last thing I'll mention in the innate or non-specific defenses, because I'm going to move on to the lymphocytes, which are your specific defenses, lymphocytes. And there's B and T, and there's subpopulations of B and T cells that I want to define for you. First, just to discuss briefly a classic experiment. Back in the 50s, how did they know it was the lymphocytes? Well, before they knew, what they did was when you do research, you have to find a model, right, to work with. And animal models weren't good, mice are commonly used. What they did was, if you irradiate an animal, first of all, see what they're doing? They're injecting the animal with an antigen, right? And when you do that, the immune system is supposed to generate an immune response, maybe make antibodies or increase the T cell population. And so when you do it to a normal animal, you have a normal response. But if you irradiate the animal, you get no immune response. So that's it. That's the model. Okay, wait a minute. No immune response. Now what we can do is, since all the cells are irradiated, we can add different cell types back and see which cell type restores the immune response. So for example, start with this one. Irradiated animal given other cells other than lymphocytes, maybe epithelial cells or something. No immune response. That's not it. But when you give the irradiated animal lymphocytes, you restore the immune response. So we study lymphocytes quite a bit for the specific defenses. And that's where the cells are responding to a particular bacterium but will be ineffective against any other foreign invader. So it's kind of like a learning process. You recognize a particular bug, you mount a response against that particular bug, but it's only for that specific pathogen and nothing else. Okay. So this requires exposure. Get this over here. All right, so we're shifting gear from non-specific to specific defenses, and basically talking about lymphocyte function. Now, remember, I said these kinds of defenses, it's basically a two-step learning process. Step one, recognition. Of the bug. So when I say exposure, when you're exposed to it, you have to recognize that you've got a bug in you, okay? And what are you recognizing? Antigens. I'll say antigens of the non-self invader. Okay, so you recognize it, and then what has to follow is the destructive properties that result from the recognition. Okay, so you have to like select a clone of lymphocyte to proliferate. So step two, first step, recognize. Step two, I'll say destructive mechanism to destroy non-self invader. And that destructive mechanism is what's called the clonal selection theory. You select the right clone that can recognize that foreign invader. Clonal selection theory, proliferate, the correct quote unquote clone, you know, it could be a B or T cell, that recognized the invader in the first place. That recognized invader. So recognize, destroy, recognize, destroy. And so, and then it helps to understand all these different subpopulations of B and T cells that have been described. B and the T. We're going to do the B first. The B cell. It stands for bursa, from like birds. I think that work was done back in the 50s, where if you take the bursa out of birds, you destroy their immune capabilities. Okay, so they named the cell after the organ from whence it was first discovered. We don't have bursa, we're not birds, but that's where the B comes from. Well, anyways, what we know about the B cells, they can become plasma cells, okay? Those are all little B cell, large round nuke. And the main thing to memorize about them is they secrete antibodies, but not to start with, okay? Usually they have membrane-bound antibodies at their cell surface. Membrane-bound, ABs. ABs is my shorthand for antibodies. And you know, basically, if that red antibody that this particular clone recognizes my foreign invader, my little red balls, and bumps into it somewhere, maybe in the lymph node or something, that might trigger its proliferation. And basically, it could become a plasma cell. Because if you look at this cell with hardly any cytoplasm, it doesn't have the machinery to make antibodies. But when you trigger its proliferation, a plasma cell is a much bigger cell. This becomes this, and it has all the cell machinery to become an antibody factory. And so it'll actually secrete these antibodies into your bloodstream. So they won't be membrane bound, they'll just circulate freely. The goal is, like, the time you got these circulating around, it can sop up all of these pathogens that are in the body. So this is the plasma cell, derived from the stimulated clone B cell. Now, of course, when you proliferate, some become plasma cells to fight the infection, right? And some will just remain B cells. Call it a memory B cell. It like remembers the first time, okay? So I guess there's a difference between this cell and this cell, even though I drew them exactly the same. This one's like, they call them naive. Competent but naive. But this is memory, has experience. So this one hangs around maybe for years, maybe your whole life, lasts forever. And if you ever get that same bug, it can mount a faster, stronger response. So memory cell, plasma cell. Okay, that's the B stuff. Now the T's, T stands for thymus. And we'll get to that when we get to lymphatics this morning. And basically, you have some T cell maturation in that organ. So the T cells, they don't secrete antibodies. They can attack virus-infected cells directly. Now, the subpopulation that does that is the cytotoxic T cell, which I have here, TC. One subpopulation. Cytotoxic T cell. Can attack the virus infected cells directly. I emphasize directly because the B cells aren't doing this hand-to-hand combat. They're secreting antibodies that will sop up the pathogen, okay? Like opsonization in complement, right? That's an example of binding up the foreign invader. All right, so you also have T helper cells, TH, the helper T cells. Now the cytotoxic and the helper T cells, they go by other names. One you should know for this lecture is by these cell differentiation proteins that are on your cell membrane. And the one for the cytotoxic T cells is CD8. and the one for the helper keys is CD4. So if I ever use the term CD8 cells or CD4 cells, the terms are interchangeable for these cell types. Now the helper Ts are really important. They basically kickstart the entire immune response. It all starts with the helper Ts. Most immune responses begin with CD4 cells. HIV, the virus that causes AIDS, obliterates CD4 cells. So that underscores the importance of this cell type. If you don't have them, you basically have AIDS. You cannot mount an immune response. So we'll look at those today. Now, these other ones, well, memory T cells, you know that.
Can the helper cells also kill cancer before it gets to the body too?
Not that I know of. Not that I know. They help. They don't do this kill stuff.
Oh.
These do the killing.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. Oh. Memory helper cells. I'll put that too. Memory T helper. So I'll just list it. They have the same function as the memory B cells. They survive. You survive an infection. You have the memory cells for the next time to mount the faster, stronger response. And then you have the T regulatory cells. Also called T suppressor cells. Also called, I think they have the CD25. Now, I'm not going to talk about these too much, but what I want you to know about them is when you mount an immune response, you want to turn it off. Okay? So these are like a break on your immune response when you get sick. People that have a problem with this cell type, they have autoimmune problems, they have severe allergies, you know, so you need them. A good example of what they do is, like, after you finish fighting an infection, these will kind of kill off the plasma cells, right? Because you don't need it anymore. They just put a brake on it. Destroy plasma cells after infection is gone. So those are all the subpopulations of the B and T cells, you should know. And to unpack this a little more, let's first talk about B cell mediated immunity. I wanted to give you a picture of what B cells respond to, and that's shown here. The foreign invader, the red structure, is presenting all these antigenic determinants. And that's what the antibodies fit. That's what they recognize. Okay, so they use a simple shape fit. So what you're showing here is basically could be three clones of B cells that each secrete antibody A, B, and C to fight this bug. And so the larger the bug, the more antigenic determinants that are presented to the host, the infected host, and we have a more of a chance of fighting it well if you can develop three clones to fight it. This is part of that recognition process. So the ABs are recognizing the antigens represented by the pathogen. That's basically what you're seeing in this slide. So to move on, so what else we got? So they secrete antibodies, and I already went through that. And you know the subpopulation, plasma, membrane. But to say something more about antibodies, they are the simplest ammunition of the immune response. But remember, like I said, they're not the murderers. They're accessories to murder. But they have great diversity. And something that you would learn in a molecular biology class, we won't talk about it here, is this notion of somatic recombination. You're shuffling the genes responsible for making these antibodies. And when you do that, you generate great diversity, 10 to the 11th power, different antibody specificity. That's a huge number. Yeah, 11 zeros after it. So, I mean, that is why you inject an animal with some random antigen that you cooked up in the lab. The animal probably has something that fits it. Okay, that's the remarkable thing about antibodies. There's no limit. I don't want to say no limit. There is a limit, 10 to the 11th power, but it's remarkable diversity. And so they target things in extracellular environments. So that's usually why you don't see plasma cells in a drop of blood. They don't usually are in the circulation. They kind of like work in the tissues where the infection is. Okay. All right, here's a picture of an antibody, and there's different classes. I mean, I kind of said that the forked end is a specific end, and I said this is the non-specific end that bumps into complement. That's all I've said so far. Antibody classes, the biggest one are called the immunoglobulin G. Antibodies are also known as immunoglobulins. And there are different classes with these capital letters. The G one represents about 80% of antibodies. It's the most prevalent one. When you first get infected, what you usually see in circulation are the IgMs. So you abbreviate immunoglobulin Ig. So IgG is like the 80%. IgMs, it's far less than that. The point is, you see these first when you're infected. I believe it's the IgGs that can cross the placenta. So in utero, that's good for baby. Now, when baby's born, you don't have the placenta anymore. But if mom nurses, there's IgAs, that class of protein is found in the breast milk. I had a student say to me once, oh, I have a friend who said, her friend, I don't know if she's talking about herself, never get sick because they're breastfed till they're 8. Ask me if that's true. I don't think it is. These are just proteins that circulate. I think they could last a few weeks, maybe a few months, but not your whole life. Cells can. Okay, so memory cells, it's better to get those. They can last your whole life. All right, so I think that's enough about the antibody classes.
Oh, I thought there were 5 of them.
Yeah, these are the ones I want you to know.
Oh.
Yeah. That's enough. And I want you to know this. This is more important. This shows that clonal selection theory I was telling you about. Look at the top of the figure. How many clones are they showing you? 3. But remember, you can have 10 to the 11th power of them. Looks like they select this one. The clonal selection theory. I was first presented as a theory in 1959. Widely accepted now. But this is the one you choose to proliferate. And when you do that to fight an infection, you're going to get some plasma cells, get your antibody titer up, right? And some persist as B cells for the next battle. So get over it, maybe get the same bug. I don't know, a few weeks later, like in my house, like I get sick, I pass it on, they pass it back to me, right? They just pass it around. Well, anyways, the second time you get it, maybe you won't even get sick. Maybe because you'll mount a faster, stronger response, more plasma cells, more memory cells. To show that in graph form, it's this figure here. The first time you're infected with bug A, you make antibodies to A, and you get your antibody titer up after, you know, a week and a half, you get better. But maybe you get infected again, second exposure, right? And then faster, stronger response. Now, if you get another bug B, the response is the same as the first exposure to bug A. Okay, so first exposure, second exposure. If you got the memory cell, you're in good shape if it's the second exposure. It takes only hours to get the max titer. Okay. Yeah, I'm using this word titer. It's just the concentration of antibody in the plasma. AB titer. How much of it do you got? So for antibodies, here's a nice summary figure that shows you everything that they can do. I call them accessories to murder, but this is really what you should know. All right, so why do they help get rid of pathogens? They fix complement, okay, that's shown here. That's the MAC attack. So when you fix complement, number one, you increase the probability it may be phagocytized or MAC attack, you just burst the cell. One thing. Precipitate. Basically, you just sop up the antigens, okay, and you just get rid of them. Agglutination. The same agglutination I talked about in blood typing. We're trying to bypass this by typing it right, because when you transfuse, you're giving them so much blood, it could kill them. Just a little bit of someone else's blood getting into yours, you'll agglutinate it out, or just neutralize, just coat. Okay. So that's kind of how antibodies can help us. And you can acquire immunity in different ways by the B cells. And there's basically, we categorize it as active or passive immunity. Okay, building up a strong immune system. So, building immunity, actively or passively. To actively get sick or get vaccinated, your immune system responds to it. Basically, what you should remember is you'll get the memory cell. Active immunity, you get sick, you respond, you get a memory cell out of it. Get another memory cell to your population of memory cells. Through the course of your life, every time you got sick and survived, you had another memory cell. Passive immunity is some way, shape, or form, you're just getting antibodies, okay? Get the immunoglobulins, receive the antibodies. However, which way? Actually, the next slide shows tables it out better. There's different kinds of active and passive. The slide here. Humoral immunity is another way of saying the B cell mediated immunity. Humoral meaning the antibodies circulate in the humors and in your blood mostly. So for active immunity, to get another memory cell, you can either do it naturally or artificially. You know, you just get sick from your kids, get sick from a classmate, a coworker, someone at church. You're just out in the world and you get sick. You don't live in a bubble. When you're out there and you interact with people. Yeah, so just getting sick out in the world is a naturally acquired form of active immunity. artificially acquired active form of immunity is you deliberately go to the clinic and get vaccinated. You know, every flu season you're encouraged to do that.
Oh, is this like for chickenpox, naturally?
Yeah, all that stuff. Yeah, like when you go to the baby, you can come back in 2 weeks, 2 months, or 2 years, and you get the shots. Right? And what are they doing? We write the word on the board, already. Officially. Get vaccinated. They're giving you, they're giving you antigens of the bug that are inactivated so you don't get sick. You're not supposed to get sick. You can have allergic reactions to vaccinations, but you should get them because you're not going to get sick most of the time, and you'll get the memory cells. Okay? And I know some people believe, have different opinions. Oh, I don't believe in that. I don't want to get vaccinated. There's this or that. And I totally disagree with it. You need to get vaccinated, your kids. If you don't, you always hear about these crazy things that come back. All these bugs we haven't seen in centuries because people don't get vaccinated. You're allowing your children who aren't vaccinated to become incubators for bugs to come back. And that's a public health risk. You're putting my kids at risk if your kids aren't vaccinated. And that's why I'm against it. It's a public health issue. It's not a personal decision. And so that's what needs to be considered in vaccination. You should decide to get them every way, every time they're available to you. You'll get the flu shot, okay? My father-in-law died from the flu. You know, it's a serious thing. Vaccinations can help us. All right, so get the cell. Now, just think about, based on everything I told you, what's better, to get the memory cell or just get the ABs?
The memory cell.
You want the cell. That thing can last your whole life, okay? Usually, you only get the ABs if you're close to death. You're in the hospital. You're in dire straits. Just drop a bag of wide spectrum antibiotics to see if you get better. Okay. Now, there's a couple ways to get it. Naturally, it's just, you know, a nursing mother. Antibodies are passed. Well, in utero, through the placenta, and also after birth in mother's milk. So that's the natural way. Mom to child. You pass the ABs from mom to child. There was the IgGs that are through the placenta, and the IgAs are in the breast milk. Okay, artificially acquired. Receive an injection of a serum. Okay, well, a good example of the artificially acquired is like the snake bit patient. For example, like take snake venom. And inject a small amount in an animal, okay? And what the animal will do is they'll generate antibodies against it. So what you do is you just collect the sera from that animal, call it anti-snake sera. And then give it to the snake bit patient. If it's, you know, figure out which snake it was, the right sera. Again, usually it's you give the antibodies if the person's really doing bad. In a snake bit patient, you're pretty close to death, so you need to help them immediately. So that's B cells. I want to transition to T cells. There are some differences, and this slide kind of introduces us to the key differences, which is the antibodies have the membrane-bound antibodies that can bind the free antigens. These can't. The T cells can. They kind of need help from antigen-presenting cells. I think that's the key difference I'm trying to show you here. B cells. Can directly bind free AGs. Remember, AGs is antigen, AB is antibody. Antigen is a word that means antibody generator, right? That's what you see here when we want to do, right? Get your antibodies. However, T cells, to activate them, require antigen-presenting cells to present the antigen to them. I like when they say the name of the cell is its function. T cell activation requires APCs, antigen presenting cells. Cells that have antigen presenting function are dendritic cells, B cells can do it, and macrophages. Okay, that's the key difference. You need a presentation. All right, so T cell mediated immunity. This slide is emphasizing the difference between the CD4s and the CD8s. You got your, well, now you introduce new terms, this MHC, okay? This APC is recognizing the CD8 because it's the correct class of MHC. And this one, class 2 MHC for the CD4 cell. It's called a MHC restriction. MHC restriction. MHC stands for major histocompatibility complex. Major histocompatibility complex. If you ever see the term HLA, same thing. That stands for human leukocyte antigen. But your book tends to use this one. I like it too. Now, why do we talk about these? Well, they interact with the T cells. MHC are extremely important. They were first discovered, I forget which decade, it was a while ago. But what they did was, they were trying to answer a very important question. They wanted to know what genes and proteins were responsible for tissue graft rejection. So they did it in inbred strains of mice. Now inbreeding is, well, think about you and your siblings if you have siblings. You and your brothers and sisters, you all of your genes are from two people, your parents, right?
You have the same immune system.
Yeah, you do, and you're genetically the same everything. Because you all have the same two parents. Now, you do the same thing with mice. The first generation, you take all the siblings, but then you inbreed those for the next generation. Can't do that with humans, right? It's immoral. But you just inbreed all the little mice, generation after generation after generation. So that strain all came from the same two parent mice. They call it an inbred strain, right? And that's a good model. When you do a tissue graft within a strain, there's no tissue graft rejection, right? Because like what you said, Felicia, like they got the same immune system. But what do you think happens if you take a tissue graft from one inbred strain and try to graft it onto a mouse of another strain? Rejection. Yeah, you reject it, right? And so they wanted to find out the genes and proteins responsible for the tissue graft rejection when you do that experiment, you kind of like graft it to another inbred strain. And they found them. And they called them histocompatibility complex. And they even dug deeper, and they said the most potent genes and proteins responsible for tissue graft rejection are major histocompatibility complex. And that's what we're talking about here in the immediate lecture. Makes sense, right? These are the genes and proteins responsible for fighting anything that's non-self. So there's two classes here, class one, class two. So class one, they are restricted to interacting with CD8s. You should memorize that. Class one, MHC. Restricted to interact with the T killer cells, the cytotoxic T cell CD8. Class two MHC, restricted to interact with the CD4s, the T helper cells. That's MHC restriction, right? And so when you're activated, you get your, you develop your subpopulations. Okay. But the key concept is MHC restriction. Class one, class two. Okay, so that's what I got here. The CD4 and 8, you know, these cells bind to different classes of MHC proteins. Class 1 MHC, CD8 cells become cytotoxic T cells. They're activated by antigen fragments linked to class 1 MHC. The class 2 MHC, CD4s become helper T cells. They bind to antigens linked to the class 2 MHCs. Okay, the antigen-presenting cells have the MHCs, and they're presenting the antigen to it. So let's take a look at this. Class 1 MHC. And I kind of outline what I think students should know when you study this. I always do it for myself in the lecture because I can never remember. So I put it on the slide so I can just look at it. You should ask yourself these questions. Class 1 MHC. Which cells can present class 1 MHC? All cells. All of your cells, except ones that don't have a nuke, because they can't make the protein, they don't have a nucleus. So that's like red blood cells. This is kind of like you're telling your immune system, hey, this is you. Don't attack you. Because it's on all your cells, all except red blood cells. All cells with the nucleus present this class 1. Well, what does the MHC display? They display an antigen synthesized from within the cell. So the cell is smart. It's just taking a piece of itself and then putting it in the groove of the MHC. And that's what you're showing to your immune system. Hey, it's me, you know, don't attack me. Because it came from within the cell. What do they present? Endogenous AG antigen. Now, however, that antigen, most of the time, it's going to be a self-antigen, your antigen. AG can be self or non-self. It may be the rare time you get sick, and if you get sick and you have viral proteins in you, you may display a non-self viral protein if you're sick. So it could be either, but it's always endogenous, came from within the cell. Okay. So the time you want to recognize it is if you're infected and you present a non-self, then that would trigger a response in the CD8. Okay, this would not. This would. So here's a picture of that. here we see any cell that has a nuke presenting MHC1. So take a piece of yourself, right, put it in the groove of class 1 MHC and display it. So every time a CD8 comes along, you don't activate it. It recognizes you as you. Okay? You don't proliferate that clone and mount it in an immune response against yourself. That's class 1. Class 2, let's ask the same questions. They're recognized by the CD4s, as we already said, but what do they present, what do they display, what kind of antigen is it? Class 2, MHC. Which cells have it? The cells with the APC function. And I already defined it. But with right here again, if you forgot, dendritic macrophage and B cells have this function. APCs present this class 2 MHC. Second question, what do they display? Exogenous antigens, okay? Foreign invaders that they've engulfed, broken down, they present a piece of it. So it's always gonna be exogenous and for that reason, non-self. Present exogenous AGs, and it's so therefore, because it's exogenous, it will always be our non-self. All right, so I pictured that too. So here's a picture of an APC cell. APC, they engulf the foreign invader, they break it into parts, they put a piece in this groove of the class 2 and display it. Hopefully the T helper cell comes along and you kick off an immune response. Remember, most immune responses start with activating the CD4. So let's look at that. T cell activation of the T helper cell, the CD4. And the things to know and how you activate it is, you need this APC to do its job. So first, the TCR recognizes MHC2, and that TCR, this stands for T cell receptor. The T cell receptor is specific for the viral antigen. There's a CD4 protein that stabilizes it, and you need a co-stimulation. So I think it's better to kind of look at a picture of this first. We'll outline it right here. So here's a picture of a CD4 helper cell on the right being activated by APC on the left. So again, we're talking about this one here. We're activating a CD4. See, I'll draw it a little differently. That's the APC. Okay, so remember, these are the class 2 MHC. I'll kind of class 2 MHC, right? And they've engulfed an exogenous antigen that is non-self. Oh, there's a red ball there. Okay, so then the right clone comes along, the CD4. The CD4 cell, it has a T cell receptor that recognizes MHC class 2. TCR. Okay. It recognizes the class 2 and it's specific for this viral AG. Specific specific to this non-self AG. This interaction is stabilized by the CD4 protein shown up top there. CD4 stabilizes this. Now, you need a co-activation. There's a couple more things. One is a co-activation. This interaction, when cells like interact like this, it triggers signals. So consider this like signal one. You need another signal because you don't. It's good to have two signals. You don't want to prematurely activate T cells and have all kinds of autoimmune stuff going on. So you need that second level of protection against premature activation. So you have these co-stimulatory molecules on the bottom here. Okay, this is a ligand called B7. This is CD28. That's what you should know. So I'm gonna squeeze it in here. B7. Another one here. Call it CD28. Consider that triggering another signal. So call it signal 2. Another thing that helps the activation is the APC is secreting interleukin-1, a cytokine that helps this activation process. So it's like cytokine called IL-1, interleukin-1, literally telling you it's between, you know, leukocytes, so that helps activation process here. So all this stuff, you got the co-stimulatory, B7, CD28, you got the MHC2, TCR, and CD4 thing, all of this is activating this CD4 cell. And when CD4s are activated, different things occur. I'll give you one, like for example, signal 1, signal 2, this shows the B7 CD28. It kind of makes the activated cell make other proteins that weren't there before, like CD154 as an example. Now it's like they kind of, now the cell will make other proteins, CD154. You're going to increase inflammation and other things. So you're basically starting, you're getting the ball rolling here. Was used to activate this. Now it'll start to secrete other interleukins like IL-2. So let's now talk about, now you've activated your T helper cell. So what does that do to further enhance the immune response besides what I wrote there, up inflammation and CD154? First, without this co-stimulation, to underscore the importance of this, if you don't have co-stimulation, that second signal, nothing happens. They call it energy. There is no immune response. Okay, so you need the co-stimulation. But if stimulated properly, here's how helper cells help. here you see the helper cell. Says here, the helper cell helps the dendritic cell to express its co-stimulatory molecules. Put this under T helper. Helps dendritic cells express its co stimulatory molecules. It's also helping to stimulate the CD8. Well, the dendritic cell can now activate the CD8, and with the help of the IL-2 secreted by T helper. So T helper also secretes IL-2. That helps to activate the CDA. So that's one way it could help. Well, actually two ways. You're helping the dendritic cell as well as the CDA. It can also help activate the B cell, and it's shown there. Basically, IL-4 is completing, the T cell releases IL-4 as co-stimulatory signals to complete B cell activation. All right, IL-4 helps to activate CD4. So pretty much it helped activate the APCs, the other kind of T cell, and the helper T cell. So when the cytotoxic T cells are activated, what do? Okay, like I said before, they can do the hand-to-hand combat. When they administer this lethal hit with perforins and granzymes. Just show you one picture there. So when CD8s are activated, can apply a quote unquote lethal hit to virus infected cells with perforins and granzymes. I had a couple more slides in this set, but they're not meant for teaching. It's just I had some review questions. I would say just add these to your study guide if you're going through that. And blood typing review. We're not ready for the blood typing lab yet, but I wanted to remind you that the written part of Lecture Gen 5 on Monday will cover blood typing. The only other thing on your online exam, which will become available today, is lymphatic. I want to cover that like right now. First of all, what is lymph? It's fluid. Here's a picture of when lymphatics fail. That's elephantitis, usually caused by a parasite infection. It blocks the lymphatic vessels. Capillary exchange that we talked about before. I write blood capillary exchange because there's lymphatic capillaries too. But it's the blood capillaries when they exchange, we talked about you know, the filtration versus absorption, that you push out more fluids than are taken up in the blood capillaries. So you have this excess fluid that needs to be picked up by the lymphatics, okay? So that's what I say here. The hydrostatic pressure in the capillaries, it pushes fluids, causing edema. Lymphatic vessels handle the edema. They can stop it up because they have leaky walls that, with proteins which act as a draw to pick up the lymph. And then so you need a drainage system to drain it back to the blood. That's great. You pick up this fluid, and you put it right back into venous blood, into blood circulation. And so we need to learn about some lymphatic vessels. In lymphatics, ducts are the biggest. Okay. So one job is to return this excess fluid, which you can call lymph, to circulation. For this reason, lymphatics is part of the circulatory system. It's contributing to the blood volume. The other main function is immunity. It's called the lymphatic system. It has lymphocytes. Immune function. Okay, so in terms of its circulation thing, I mean, you need to understand lymphatic capillaries. There's lymphatic trunks, but the biggest one are ducts. I'll put a star next to that because I don't really have you know the anatomy of or named vessels that are trunks or capillaries, but we have a couple of ducts that are named that I want you to know. They are the right lymphatic duct and the thoracic duct. Those are the two ducts you got to know. Right lymphatic duct as well as thoracic duct. So know those two as anatomy structures that help in circulation. For the immune function, we will discuss various lymphatic tissues and organs. So here's a picture of the circulation, starting with the capillaries. Lymphatic circulation begins at the capillary level, and it's a one-way street to a vein. So that's what you see here. Here's the blood capillaries, okay, intertwined with lymphatic capillaries, picking up the excess fluid, and it's starting to take it back to the veins. And so along the way, you have venous valves, and you have lymph nodes. Valves, you know, what they do, kind of like the same thing in veins. They prevent the backwards flow. If you push them all the way to the venous system, you contribute to the blood volume. And along the way, you have these lymph nodes in a row. They're packed out with lymphocytes. So if there's an infection in your interstitial, it could be picked up by the lymph. And it could be recognized by lymphocytes that reside within the lymph node. Okay, so that's what lymphatics do for it. You got lymph nodes all over the place. The key ones are cervical region, axillary region, and inguinal region. So all of those three regions is where you have lymph nodes, which is one of the lymph organs we'll look at. Lymph nodes located in these key regions: cervical, axillary, inguinal. I've heard that when you perform mastectomy due to breast cancer, you remove the lymphatics. So it helps to sleep with your arm elevated to help the drainage because you've removed the lymph along with the vessels. Here's an anatomically correct picture of what I want you to know. You already wrote down right lymphatic duct thoracic duct. Add to that cisternic hyoid. Got that. It's not a duct, but I'll just list it here. It's one you gotta know. Cisterna. Hyoid. Well, just look at the picture. You can see how the drainage goes. All drainage leads back to those two ducts, right? Lymphatic duct, thoracic duct. The light green is the regions of the body of all the lymph received by right lymphatic duct into this venous angle here. All other regions are drained to cisterna chyli and to thoracic duct, which drains right there on the left side. So that's why I had you know these three structures. They're receiving all the lymph, but you got lymph everywhere. You have lymph nodes, mostly here, here, or here. That's why you go to the doctor's office and they palpate your lymph nodes. If they're swollen, it means you're finding an infection. All right, so here's a more anatomically beautiful picture of just these two ducts. I have a close-up picture here, you can see a little better. Let me skip a slide here, this one. The right lymphatic ducts and thoracic ducts, here's the right one, very short duct. Here's the thoracic duct, it comes from up here. They're emptying into the angle created by internal jugular vein and subclavian vein. Clear the board here. Both the right lymphatic duct and thoracic duct drain into the venous angle created by internal jugular vein and brachiocephalic vein. I'll just say IJV and brachiocephalic vein. Those are veins you should know from the previous test. And move on. So let's kind of go back. Those are the ducts, but let's go back. How do you first pick up the lymph? Let's look at the lymph capillary. There's two kinds of valves to know when you study the lymph capillary. Lymphatic capillaries have primary valves and secondary valves. What you're seeing here is this primary valve is like a flap. Primary valves are also called flap-like mini valve. You ever see that term? It's just overlapping cells. Cells that overlap. And what happens is, what they're trying to show you is, there's these little filaments that anchor one end of a cell. So let's say you anchor one end of a cell, but this is free to flap open if there's a pressure and it kind of like opens the flap and it allows lymph to enter. So that's how it kind of gets in. You get in through the primary valve. Lymph gets in. But then you have to push it forward, and that's how the secondary valves help. So let me advance the slide here. So the top figure is the primary valve or flap-like mini valve. What they're showing you here is, it's hard to see from the back, maybe, you have these overlapping cells. Here's a close-up view. You just let it in. Okay. Call that the expansion phase. Then you compress, and that pushes it forward. When you compress, you close the flap-like mini valve, pushing it forward through this secondary valve, also called a internal valve. Secondary valves, aka internal valves. Push lymph through these valves. During compression. That's basically what you're doing there. You're just pushing the lymph forward from capillaries to trunks to ducts, eventually delivering it back to the venous angle. Okay, but along the way, you're going to have all these lymph tissues, like in lymph nodes. I wanted to show a slide. This is actually from our collection of the main tissue type, cingulate lymphatics, reticular tissue. So what you're seeing here is a mesh created by reticular fibers. All the blackish fibers you're seeing, all the pinkish stuff, those are the cells, probably lymphocytes. There are other kinds of cells here. I just listed them here. All the kinds of, these top three are immune cells, and then reticular cells, which actually make the fibers. And dendritic cells as well. So you got this sponge-like mesh. I mean, imagine trying to push fluid through a mesh like this. It slows it down, and that's good. You only give time for antigenic encounters inside your lymph tissues. Okay. So talking about tissues, mostly reticular tissue, and it's like a mesh that slows the flow of lymph. Example of a lymph tissue called MALT in your, you have it in several places in the body. This one comes from the small intestine. So lymph tissues found in MALT, which is actually a capitalized abbreviation for mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. And I'm not going to write it out, I always just call it MALT, but you can look that up if you forget. MALT is lining the small intestine. That's a good place to have lymph tissue. You know, if like a fly lands on your food and you eat it anyways, maybe you don't see it. The little germs that get in your food and pass through your digestive tract, it's a good place to have it. And so what you're looking at here, the food would pass through the top of the figure. This is like the intestinal wall. We'll talk about it when we get there. So things get absorbed this way. The big purple splotch is the MALT. Probably purple because it's packed out with lymphocytes. They usually stay in purple. So you have these efferent lymphatics as you go from the lumen of the intestine to lymphatics here. Okay. Determine lymphatics. The only other, there are other lymph tissues I'll mention. I mean, you have, let me give you one example I don't have a picture of. You have lymph tissues in malt, tonsils. I'll teach you the different tonsils of the oral cavity, also in digestion. Okay, so basically malt and tonsils, lymph tissues. Now, if you put a capsule around lymph tissue, you call it an organ. Lymph organ is basically lymph tissue with a capsule present. So I want you to know lymph nodes, spleen, and thymus. We'll start with the lymph node. There's a nice picture of a lymph node. We have a nice model of the lymph node. It's over here. Yeah, right there. Go ahead. Keep your look at that one. That's a new one. All right, so we've cut it open here so we can see the organization of the inside. There's basically a cortex and medulla, and we have this capsule surrounding it. You got lymph node, spleen, thymus. And we'll talk about all three of them, starting with the lymph node. So the organization is, well, first, how does lymph pass through this thing? It's coming in this way, going out that way. So when it comes in, you call that afferent lymphatics. When it goes out, you call it efferent lymphatics, stuff passing through. Lymph nodes are the only lymph organ to receive afferent lymphatics. Have a lot in a row. So if you're in the center of that row, you're getting lymph that already was filtered through a previous lymph node, and you're going to pass it on to another lymph node that's after you. Because remember, what's the goal here? You're trying to fight infection. So it's like you want to like put the bad guys that are floating in your lymph through as many lymph nodes as possible to try to mount an immune response to it. So you expect these to be packed out with lymphocytes. There are. Efferent lymphatics come in, say here for example. You go in, what do? You have in the cortex these lymphoid follicles, and you have a choice. You can do one of two things. You can go through the follicle, which is good, because you got B and T cells and macrophages there. So efferent lymphatics enter. You can do two things. Do one of two things. You can go through the lymphoid follicle. Where you got the Bs, the Ts, and remember M, phage, that's my shorthand for macrophage. You got the immune cells there. That's good. You can probably have an antigenic encounter there if it's the right clone, right? Or you can go around. There's these flow-through channels called trabecular sinus. There's all the space around all the lymphoid follicles. trabecular sinus, and you avoid getting found if you're the pathogen, I guess. Go around through trabecular sinus. So if you get out of the cortex, remember these follicles are in the cortex of the lymph node, throat cortex, you know. Then you flow to the inner part, the medulla. Now the medulla has medullary cords and medullary sinuses. Enter medulla. And the medulla has cords. The cords contain primarily T cells. So that's another spot for an antigenic encounter. The T cells are in the cords. You also have an option just to avoid the cord and just go flow out undetected through the medullary sinus. So I'll just put sinus. And then you leave, okay? You enter the cortex, enter the medulla, then leave. Call it efferent lymphatics. So if you're a bad guy and you made it through the gauntlet, you didn't undetected, you're going to go through another and you're like, oh no, again? There's all these B and T cells all around me. And so there's a good chance of your lymphatic system will fight the infection for you. It's filtering all your lymph repeatedly in all these different regions of your body. And if there's an infection there in the lymph, it can be found. Now the spleen, it like does the same thing except for your blood. So the spleen is to, you know, the blood as the lymph node is to the lymph. It's the largest mass of lymphoid tissue in the body. You have a nice picture of it there. It fights infections that are bloodborne. That's the key. Basically, fights bloodborne infections. That's a close-up picture. I mean, where is it? It's easy to find. It's intraperitoneal. When I open the body cavity on cadavers, I can find it in like a couple of seconds. Oh, right there. Because it's left of the stomach. I can see the stomach easily, and just right there on the left. Kidneys are hard to find. They're retroperitoneal, but I have no problem finding the spleen. Left of the stomach.
Is there only one spleen, right?
Yeah, one spleen. Yeah, but you got two kidneys, as we'll see. Now, this picture on the right, you've removed the stomach so you can see the splenic artery coming off the abdominal aorta. A lot of blood in the spleen. In fact, during a sympathetic response, when you want to squeeze all the blood out of your veins, you can also squeeze a little bit of blood out of the spleen as well as the liver to add to the blood volume during a sympathetic response. The spleen has a capsule, there's a little bit of smooth muscle that can contract because it's basically a sponge of blood. Okay, so know the spleen, know the splenic, artery and vein. Okay, that's important blood supply. If you were to cut it open and look at the tissue, there's basically, upon fresh dissection, red pulp and white pulp. So the red pulp is your blood, your red blood cells. That's what makes it red. Blood red. The white pulp is your lymphocytes. I'll just say lymph tissue. Now again, when you look at these under the microscope, they take a purple color. Now this picture's not so good as this one. Turn the lights off. The white pulp is purple, and it has an artery through it, central arteriole. I mentioned that before as an example of an arteriole. You're putting your blood through a cuff of white pulp. So if you've got a blood-borne infection, it's like, again, you're putting it through the gauntlet. I don't know why I'm using that term, but there's a good chance you'll find it in the blood, you know, this white pulp. Everywhere else is basically red pulp. Okay. Here's a better picture showing you the circulation of the spleen that I want you to know. Call it splenic circulation. What we'll see is the splenic circulation is a good example of open circulation. Because usually, well, all the time, circulation is closed. This is an exception. What I mean by closed is we've been studying blood circulation. It always goes arteries, capillaries, veins, back to the heart, right? And it's all connected. There's no break. But what we'll see here is there's a break. There's an open spot where blood just filters out. And I'll show it to you when you get there. So, let's just talk about how blood first gets in. Blood first gets in, I'll just kind of point it out here. Maybe hard to see in the back, but there's a little SA here. That stands for splenic artery. It kind of branches off and goes through here, and you have an artery that we call the central arteriole. Let me write that down. Here goes splenic artery. Then it branches out, and you get the smaller arteries. Call it a central arteriole. This figure calls it a central artery, but it's really an arteriole. Now, here's the thing. It's surrounded by a cuff of white pulp. Here, they call it PALS. Central artery surrounded by PALS. P-A-L-S, which stands for periarteriolar lymphoid sheath. Write that out. Periarteriolar lymphoid sheath. Remember the goal here, we're finding blood-borne pathogens. So that's the first level of defense. Put it through your lymph tissue, okay? Now, the other thing you do is there's these little branches coming off central arteriole. That says PA, which stands for penicillary artery, a little branch. Up here, penicillary artery. That penicillary artery leads to this little end sac called an SC, a sheath capillary. So on the figure, it's PASC. So this is the open circulation I was talking about. An example of open circulation. Okay, the sheath capillary, it's surrounded with, well, it's hard to see, like, there's my PA. There's my SC. And you're pushing blood into this cul-de-sac, this little end sac. And that's unusual. OK? capillaries are like that, the ones we've talked about. They're connected directly to a venule, right? But this is like a dead end. And the dead end is surrounded with macrophages. So it's like if you're a bloodborne pathogen and you make it through the PALs without being detected, then you get to this cul-de-sac, you're like, oh my gosh, there's all those macrophages that want to eat me. Okay, this is why the spleen helps fight infection. If you can make it through there, well, let's pretend you make it or don't, but that's another level of defense. The capillaries got macrophages lining the streets. Okay. So blood goes through there. There's a gap between the capillary and the sinus. That's the venous blood. I'll use a different color here. Sinus. Squeaky eraser marker here. Okay, sinus is venous blood. I know I'm using green, but I already used blue, so. You filter out of the sheath capillary. Think of the sheath capillary as a filter. You get out of that, you're in the organ. You've left the closed circulation. You're just in what's called the red pulp. The red pulp is all the space outside the sheath capillary. Call it RP. They put a little RP in the gap between the capillary and the sinus, which is venous blood, okay? So that's why it's open. So basically, if you are a red blood cell and you get filtered out of the sheath capillary and you're in the red pulp, but then you make it in the venous blood, you're on the way out. Exit via splenic vein. So to review splenic circulation, they come in, splenic artery, branch out, branch out, branch out. You have central arterial in the PALs, penicillia or artery, sheath capillary, and you filter out, you're in the red pulp. If you're a young, vibrant red blood cell. They're usually more flexible. They can navigate their way through the vessel wall of the sinus and get back in the blood and remain in your bloodstream. If you're old, dead, and dying red blood cell, they're usually more stiff. So then when you get filtered out of the red pulp, they can't make it back in. So this is where the old red blood cell goes to retire and die, basically. The spleen is a retirement home for your done with red blood cells. Okay, here's another picture of it. The SC, sheath capillary, is shown in longitudinal section here. They're showing it there. Okay, so that's the filtering area. So anywhere else is NFA, non-filtering area. Okay, by default, I guess. So again, the young red blood cells, they'll get picked up by the red pulp. But if you're old, dead, and dying, they'll just kind of remain in the red pulp, and they'll probably recycle you for your parts in the spleen. Okay, so that's spleen. Know the splenic circulation. One more organ to talk about here, that's just the thymus. Here's a thymus of a young 2-year-old. It kind of atrophies in adults. When you're young, that's when you're building your immunity. This is the most active thymus. And this is where T cells go to mature. They go from bone marrow to thymus for more maturation. So we call this like a T-cell education. Show you a picture here. T-cell education is we call it a development of self-tolerance. And clear the board. education in quotes. I mean, basically, it's a selection process. You're trying to select the T cells that will work for you and not cause an autoimmune response or fail to recognize non-self. I mean, we call it immunocompetent. That's what you want. So, what's the big picture here? Basically, what I want you to see from the histological picture is that there's a cortex and medulla. The less mature, the more immature T cells are out here in the darker purple, that's the cortex. The slightly lighter purple is the medulla, where the more mature, competent T cells will go to enter the circulation. So out here, the T cells, you got some good ones, got some bad ones. And you don't want to prematurely activate the bad ones. So you want to protect the blood from these immature T cells. So in the cortex, the reticular epithelial cells, they produce hormones thymosin and thymopoietin. You don't have to really know those. But what you need to know is that those epithelial cells, they surround blood vessels, forming a blood-thymus barrier. That prevents the premature activation of T cells. So in the cortex, reticular epithelial cells, surround blood vessels, forming a blood thymus barrier. Here's a picture of, well, same picture, but just telling you that the medulla stains a little lighter. It's the same stuff, except the reticular endothelial cells, they surround the blood vessels. They don't form a barrier. They don't have a tight junction. So they allow the immunocompetent T cells to enter the blood circulation. There's no blood barrier. Immunocompetent T cells enter the circulation here. Immunocompetent T cells enter circulation. So here's what's happening in the cortex and medulla. This development of self-tolerance. Basically, you want to tolerate yourself. You don't want to activate against yourself. You want to tolerate yourself. Okay? You want to recognize yourself and tolerate it without activating yourself to attack yourself. Well, here's the questions that I think you should ask yourself. This selection process is a two-round selection process. You go through a round of positive selection and negative selection. Let me outline here what's there, what I think you should know. Self-tolerance. Okay, that first round, this positive selection. Ask yourself this question. Does the T cell that you're trying to find out, that's good or bad, does the T cell react to MHC1? Put it in form of a question. It's a yes-no question. Does does the T cell react to MHC1? No, well, let me ask you, do you want that? Do you want it to recognize MHC1? Say, for example, if you're a CD8? Yeah, you want that. So if it's a yes, you recognize, remember, the first step of the learning process of adaptive immunity, you have to recognize self from non-self. So it helps to recognize self. So if the answer is yes, that cell lives. If the answer is no, it dies. It goes into apoptosis. Spelled apoptosis, although the second P is silent. Right, so then you live to the next round. The next round is negative selection. I think the key question you ask there is, does the T cell react to a self antigen? Self AG. Do you want it to react to yourself? You don't. If you react to yourself, you're going to attack yourself. That's what these cells do. They're attackers. So, if the answer is yes, you react to yourself, that's no good. So, yes will initiate apoptosis. If you recognize MHC1 and you don't react to self, you live. And those are the ones that enter the circulation. There's a picture of this selection process. Round one, positive selection. Can you recognize yourself? This doesn't fit. The TCR doesn't fit MHC1. Go away. If you can bind, but not too tightly, but if you bind good enough, I say loosely binding, and there's the AG there. You bind good enough, you recognize that you live. You live to see the second round. Okay, if you react to self, pretend that's a self AG, and you bind too tightly, this triggers a signal, that first signal, and you don't want that. You don't want to react to self. So if you recognize MHC1 but don't react to a self AG, then leave a little gap there. I say bind less tightly. Well, then that's a no, and the no's live. Okay, you enter the circulation. All right, let's take a break. That finishes the material for your online exam. Now, when we come back, I gotta warn you, I gotta start the next unit, respiratory. Otherwise, Monday's gonna be too painful for me. All right, so when we come back, a little more lecture, then I'll leave plenty of time to do your blood typing lab. I'll see you in about 20 minutes.